Good afternoon, everyone. A very warm welcome to this, our second lunchtime concert of the semester, whether you're here in the room with us or watching on our live streaming. We're delighted to have you with us. I have a few short announcements. The first is an apology to those of you who have got the rogue programs which aren't properly printed. We don't quite know what happened there, but our performers will be telling you what they're about to play and telling you about it from the podium. In any case, you don't need to worry. We hope you enjoy the Biber in today's program. If you do, there's a chance to hear more Biber in the concert a week on Friday in the evening, which will be a tremendous occasion and something of a first for us, because the music that we will be hearing will be interpreted by a dancer in real time in this room. So it should be very exciting. Tickets are on sale in the Bayer Theatre box office already, so please do book up for that. That's a week on Friday, the Bach Players. Loads and loads more concerts happening this semester. If you haven't already picked up this semester's season brochure, please do so. There's an awful lot of great things coming up. And the final announcement is to tell you that shortly after this concert, at 2:30 today, Dr. Fabrice Fitch from the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland will be giving a music talk on reconstructing an Obrecht mass, which is going to be a fascinating insight into the practical work that musicologists and performers have to do. And Fabrice promises there'll be lots of practical examples, so it should be very, very interesting indeed. That's at 2:30, right here after today's concert, and everyone is welcome to come along to that. I'm delighted to introduce today's performers. It's always a particular pleasure when our associate teachers, who work so hard with our students and scholarship groups throughout the year, also perform for us. And Ben Shute has made a huge impact in the short time he's been with us as our associate teacher of violin. So it's a particular pleasure to welcome him and on harpsichord, Anastasia. Please give them a warm welcome.
It's wonderful to be with you today. I've heard that there were some program shortages, so I was going to say a few words anyway, so I'll just mention pieces in a little bit more detail by name, so that if you don't have a program, you don't have to worry. So we'll open the program today with not just a prelude for violin, but a new prelude for a new violin. This is a baroque violin that was made for me in 2021 by Robert Broad of Philadelphia, modeled on the 1741 Feuilleton Guarnieri del Gesù. But it seemed to like quite thick and chordal sonorities. So this first piece on the program is a prelude that I've entitled Adoramus. And it's inspired by the kinds of lush textures in British Renaissance music that I loved so much. You have Tallis and Taverner south of the border, and Robert Carver up in Scotland, just creating these gorgeous textures. And to do that within a more baroque harmonic and technical idiom, I just thought there was some interesting room for exploration there. So that's the first piece. It's in two chiastically structured halves, and the second half is exactly the first half upside down. So that's the first piece. After that, Anastasia will play two pieces for harpsichord. It's the it's a Passacaglia by Johann Caspar Kerll, and Chaconne by Fischer. And these two genres, Passacaglia and Chaconne, are closely related. They're both built on a ground bass or a repeating bass line. So it's interesting in listening to music like this to keep an ear out for this ground bass and to hear how composers of this period could find development within stasis and novelty amidst repetition. It's a fascinating duality that creates. After that, we'll play two sonatas together. The first is the Crucifixion Sonata of Heinrich Bieber. It's from a collection of sonatas that are known as the Mystery or Rosary Sonatas, because in the score that exists, there's a wood carving or a woodcut illustrating the different steps of the rosary. So Bieber was a devout Catholic composer living in Austria in the 17th century. So for that, I'm actually using a different instrument, because almost every one of these sonatas calls for a different tuning of the violin. And that yields not only different chordal possibilities, but also a different sound to the instrument itself, because you have different sympathetic resonances within the instrument. This violin actually is a 1775 Joseph Ruddiman of Aberdeen. I got it years back in the States when I had no idea that we would be coming to Scotland. But it's basically an old Scottish fiddle that was never modernized. So this is its Scottish debut in I don't know how many years, but I'm sure it's happy to be back home. And I don't know how well you can see from out there, but I've got this massive, thick, so all of these are plain gut sheep intestine strings. That's the norm for Baroque instruments. But usually the G string would have been wound with metal from about 1650, but there's good evidence that Bieber, in his tradition, might well not have done that. So I'm using a thick, plain gut G string. It's a very, you'll hear, it's a very earthy sound, but it's somehow appropriate for the piece itself is very stylistically refined in some ways, but the aesthetic is actually, there's a real rawness to it. Perhaps befitting the theme of the crucifixion, but I think that those plain gut strings really contribute to that effect. There's so much to say about Bieber that obviously we don't have room to scratch the surface here, but a lot of symbolic thinking, a lot of representational thinking that would influence subsequent composers, and of course Bieber himself being influenced by the Lutheran tradition and medieval traditions before that. Growing out of that same tradition is Johann Sebastian Bach, and we'll conclude the program with Bach's E major sonata for violin and harpsichord. It seemed appropriate after the dark G minor of the crucifixion to end with the bright and luminous E major that Bach himself often associates with resurrection. So the interesting thing about this, the Bach E major sonata, is that most Baroque, I'll call them violin sonatas for lack of a better term, use keyboard instruments implicitly in the role of basso continuo, where you'll have a violin line and a bass line, and under the bass line will be numbers that are basically the 17th and 18th century equivalents of maybe modern guitar chord charts. And it tells the players what chords to improvise over the bass line. And there are all sorts of, according to the time and nationality that you're talking about, all sorts of different ways of doing that. And I'm very fortunate that that's one of Anastasia's specialties. So the Bieber operates according to this paradigm. It's a sonata for violin and basso continuo, whereas the Bach, Bach actually dispenses with the continuo and writes out a right-hand part for the harpsichord. So it's almost as though you have a trio sonata for two instruments. And it's a little bit of genre bending there, and Bach does that sort of thing all the time. He'll write, you know, a concerto for one harpsichord. The word concerto means, we're not sure, either a playing together or a striving against, but in any case it implies multiplicity, and Bach will write a concerto for one harpsichord. He's often thinking in terms of taking the language of his day and using it in new and often very intellectual ways. But the amazing thing about Bach and Bieber like him is that they can take a really rich intellectual tradition and infuse it with a lot of soulfulness. And I think in their tradition, those two would not really have been seen as separate. So it's fascinating for us to be able to play this music and to just engage with old ideas that, in some ways, you know, these instruments are different than the instruments that we use today, but that in some ways speak very, very clearly to us today, and, you know, breathing new life into old music, which of course is what the act of performance always is anyway. You have the notes on the page, but then there's the question of how do you make them alive in any given context, and that's a thrilling thing for us, because no context is the same, every audience is different. So we'll dive in and just play in the present context. One last thing I will say is, because this is a short-ish program, we've chosen works to try to have a nice narrative flow, so to speak, throughout the program. So any applause or anything you may be inclined to give willingly or grudgingly, we just ask that you wait till the end so that we can have a big flow through the program. And yeah, so without further ado,
would help if I got a bow.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. take